so I think we'll go ahead and get started. Hope everyone can hear. So good evening and welcome to the third and final talk of the Spring 2016 Design and Computation Lecture Series. My name is Theodora Vardouli. I'm a fourth year PhD candidate in the Design and Computation group. And I've had the pleasure to be organizing this year's lecture series with Professor Terry Knight. So I'd like to take the opportunity to also thank everyone who helped make this series a success, my PhD colleagues who introduced and welcomed some of the speakers, the students who have been helping with the audiovisual coverage, and all the department staff that have been helping with sort of administrative organizational issues. So themed computational mediations, this lecture series has been probing new modalities of action, agency, and expression, emerging from the confluence of human intentionality with the properties of computational technologies. Collectively, the speakers that we've had so far have been addressing questions such as, how does computation inflect processes of design and making? What is the role of design and designers in instituting new kinds of human-technology relationships? And can mediation itself become a locus of design? We're delighted to welcome our last speaker for this series, Professor Shona Kitchen, whose prolific artistic, pedagogical, and research work interrogates experiential, social, and environmental effects of our technological landscapes, present and future. Shona Kitchen currently heads the Digital and Media Program in the Rhode Island School of Design. She holds a degree from the Royal College of Art. Since graduating from the RCA, she has worked with numerous academic institutions such as Stanford University, the Royal College of Art, the San Jose State University. And her trajectory also includes professional collaborations with Sony, Comme des Garçons, Samsung, IBM, and the City of San Jose Public Art Program. Through multidisciplinary work in architecture and interaction design, art, and conceptual narrative architectural proposals, Shona Kitchen problematizes current technological developments and speculates on possible futures. Recent projects include the Neighborhood Watch Files, which is a research project, I believe, and a setting out a curated show at Apex Art in New York City. So please welcome, join me in welcoming Shona Kitchen.
Great. Thank you. So can everybody hear me okay? Does that need to be louder? So I'm very honored to be here this evening. Just for your information, I do come from a kind of architecture degree from the Royal College of Art. I wouldn't call myself an architect, but I do have that as a background, which I'm very thankful for, because the nature of the work that I developed after that really required and benefited from the rigor of architecture. I did an architecture degree under Nigel Coates. From that, I then moved into research at the RCA, which involved interaction design. So I've kind of like moved across many disciplines. I taught in product design, researched in interaction design, worked in developing architectural interiors that were kinetic. But the body of work that I'm going to show today is predominantly research. And what I'll say is that in digital plus media at RISD, we have about 30 graduate students, and they all come from varying disciplines. So they're kind of thinking about our technology, but in a wide range of forms. So just to talk a little bit about my work, it investigates new forms of social and urban experience. And again, it proposes systems of technological objects which act as intermediaries between architectural landscape and virtual space. Intangible computer-generated spaces bump up against real spaces, drawing together language, sensibilities that often appear to be at odds with one another, such as pleasure and technology, poetry and industrial landscape. Sorry, I think you turned that up. So the work interrogates everyday technologies that form and inform the multiplicity of worlds that we live in today, from social networking, anomalies, control, mediation, and political identities. It positions itself where the poetic crosses the science fiction and built realities through a range of mediums and fields. catalyzing a questioning of how technology affects our perception of past, present, and future, and seek to create space for audience to reflect on the social, psychological, and cultural relationships that are the result of the supported and surrounded by technology. So one of my huge inspirations, does anyone know G.G. Ballard? Since the beginning of time, since 97, he's really inspired me. And I think a lot of the work that you'll see really draws from, I think, the structure and the process of how he works, or how he worked. In stepping into the reality of the built landscape and looking at it socially, politically, and psychologically, and not jumping ahead in the pure fantasy or speculation, but really talking about now rather than speculated futures. So this image here, I've actually got a lot of images to show, so I'm going to move through things quite quickly. But if you do have a question, then just put your hand up, I can answer it then. So things that inspire me, here you'll see a supercomputer, and it's called RC, and it's housed in a 1920s chapel in Catalonia in Spain. So for me, you know, that balance between technology and religion becomes quite ironic. What I find architecturally, sculpturally quite beautiful, here you see a discarded nuclear test site, which is in the Pacific Isles. Again, you know, we try to repair the landscape that we've damaged, but sometimes in that repairing, it actually ends up being more stunningly beautiful than any piece of art could be, or landscape art. I'm interested in communities and how communities adapt and grow and change depending on their needs. Here you see a fly-in community. So they've created a space that suits them because they don't have cars, they have planes. Panawave, a community that are in fear of electromagnetic energy. It's interesting, being around Rhode Island, you see a lot of shrink-wrap boats, but they're actually quite beautiful. Here you see helicopters shrink-wrapped because they're going off into the desert, so they obviously have to be tight-sealed in shipping. Whenever I've worked with students, I've always tried to take them to places that are places they wouldn't normally go. We managed to take a group of students from RCA, to Star City in Moscow. And here you see I've forgotten the name of it, I'm sure, the anti-gravity chamber. Or here you'll see the Titan Missile Museum in Tucson, Arizona. Has anyone been to Tucson, Arizona? No. It's amazing. It's one of the last remaining missiles from the Cold War. And again, you know, with the kind of work we do, it's very, you look at the communities that are living or have lived in these structures. So this gentleman here actually worked in this building along with this missile during the Cold War. And to go back there now, the remnants are the community that worked there are an elderly community, but they were young during the Cold War. So stepping into this space, it's kept beautifully. It smells of cleaning fluid. So it's, again, you know, that preserving. It's like they were brought up in this environment. And I think that's important when thinking about architecture, or the responsibility of architecture, is that it is, you're not necessarily building it for there and now, but people, a community might be part of that all of their life. Biosphere in Tucson, again, that was a space created to test out how the kind of psychological and physical survival of people on Mars. So I'm going to quickly talk about a couple of projects from the RCA. This is a student, Tim Simpson, and his piece was called subversive sightseeing. And it was simply creating a standard system that we all are aware of. It wasn't something that looked alien, that would allow you to see, so if you look here, so allow you to perceive or see the city in a way that you wouldn't normally see it, to experience it. And it was kind of drawing from the realities of catastrophes in the city. So if you look on the big wheel, in a few moments you'll see a glitch there. Unless it's been fixed, there we go. So he was just playing with the idea of perception. Bjorn Frank created this piece called Affective Sensory Extensions. And again, you know, we try and kind of mend or protect ourselves, but this piece, he was pushing it that little bit further where if you're out in the sun, you know, we kind of lather ourselves in sunscreen. Here he actually sacrificed a piece of his skin in order for him to understand how much damage he was doing to his body. And then that would mean that he would step out sooner rather than later. Sony PlayStation, this was a project. So I have a lot of this work. Again, it's very collaborative. Sony sponsored PSP was with a long-term collaborator, Ben Hooker. And it was sponsored by PSP, and they were looking at alternative ways that, or the experience of gaming, both in the virtual and in the real. So what we proposed to do was actually take one specific game called Burnout into the actual city. So it became a site-specific game. So you see the platform straddled across the highway. Might want to turn that down a bit. So this was a quick project that was just exploring the idea of gaming and it being site specific. And this kind of work kind of tended to kind of sit within gallery context. The weekend, again with Ben, and the weekend is simply a sign that reminds you it's the weekend. So at 5 o'clock on a Friday, and this is in German, so it says the weekend, at 5 o'clock on a Friday, this will switch on, and it'll stay on until Sunday evening. Again, it's just a simple, you know, in today's environment, it's like, you know, we forget to switch off. So kind of creating these products that kind of interfere with technology, even though they're using technology, or interfere with this lifestyle that we have of no rest. So a little bit briefly on research within the RCA. This project was called Presence. It was a two-year EU-funded project. And a lot of the projects I've shown so far are, 97 and to 2001. So I will move to kind of more recent projects. And this project was looking at how we were supported, we were asked to investigate and kind of think about how within the, for this housing community on the outskirts of Amsterdam, which is, was extremely kind of diverse and not a very wealthy community, how the elderly could, through technology, could play a bigger part. So we simply created these interventions that were, again, they weren't alien. They were drawn from the fact that everybody understood what a bench was. Everybody understood what a television was. And these devices, so the bench, for example, allowed the elderly community to write their own slogans, almost their own graffiti, that would then be housed within the bench, and they could change it electronically from their home. So if they were feeling a certain way, they could simply program the bench, and it would rotate and display a slogan of their choice. And it was using a very basic system in the old days when they had on buses. If anyone doesn't understand what I'm saying, because I use a different language sometimes, using buses, it would be a paper roller. It wouldn't be digital. So the elderly community, they wrote all the slogans on these mechanisms. Edgetown was one of Ben and I's first kind of individual or separate research project. And it was looking at landscape. For example, here you see images from around the M25 in London. And it's where, you know, you'll have a switchyard rubbing up against an airport, against a trash site. So quite a kind of a live, but a space that people tend to turn their back to. So we came up with an idea of a place, a community that lived in a. It wasn't really a space, it was a space that kind of straddled the highway called Edgetown. And what we were interested in is that how we can design interfaces that flow and use the electronic data and use it to enrich and complement others rather than kind of more of a material phenomena. So here you see typical images of. So this was the proposal where we'd have housing that would straddle across the highway so that you could enjoy gray set rather than sunset. And it was, in a way, not turning our back and moving on to something else, but trying to live in the damaged landscape that we'd actually created. So again, thinking about this data landscape and how we could use the pollution to maybe drive and thrive and feed what we then went on to create as an electronic foliage. So this is the idea of the perfect house across the highway. Part of it would be thick concrete for sound pollution, whereas the rest of it would almost be like this open garden. Where we came up with ideas for electronic foliage and drawing inspiration from someone like David Attenborough, where these plants would have behaviors similar to real plants, but would then be kind of communicating to each other and pollinating each other with data. So these were the prototypes that we developed in CARD first. We then thought about the actual behavior of these plants. So here you see dust, the dust particle catcher, where dust would collect from the highway and connect these conductive strips that then would set off a wiper, and then the patterns from that dirt could possibly then be displayed in the home. We then pushed one product a little bit further, and this is a cellular noisemaker. So again, it's kind of reminiscent of the ghetto blaster. So the signal was then pollinating another plant. So the idea that in the LCD screen, it would incubate this information And like a dandelion, is it dandelion? Where at a certain time, all the seeds blow, disperse. This was kind of the inspiration for this piece. So living in Edgetown, obviously you wouldn't necessarily want to go to, you wouldn't necessarily go to a park on the outskirts that was full of deer. You might actually go to and hang out at the end of the runway for Heathrow Airport, for example, and go to Sensor Park. So Sensor Park would be this park you could go to in order to experience the real planes coming into land, but also the data that was being, the data around aviation. So starting to reveal and understand the data landscape. So Electroplex Heights moved on from Edgetown, and this was a commission by Vitra Design Museum. So Electroplex Heights was, again, drawing inspiration from structures like an oil platform. So an oil platform will be constructed, put in one place, but then could easily be moved to another. So the idea was to create a platform that would live above the constructed landscape. So it would be based around a community. I mean, I don't know if any of you enjoy watching construction sites, or, you know, over the period of a year, you see the foundations, then gradually you see the finished piece. So it was to do with a community that might embrace and enjoy living above a landscape under construction. So each of the apartment complexes were a community searching for fresh meaning in urban life. So here you see a plan view. And again, the platforms were sited above land use fault lines, provide dwellings for two contrasting views, one of the continuous construction and destruction of development, and one of pockets of tranquility. So these sites might sit next to a derelict call center, for example. And then thinking about if you lived in this dwelling, you know, there might be bespoke products that would allow you to, for example, connect to the North Sea. And the idea that, again, that you're creating this architecture, but there was a community that started to grow. And it's interesting because, you know, in small towns, you do get these local newspapers, which I always find really fascinating. So the idea that these communities would have their own newspaper, for example, this one was called New Frontiers, and it might be that new sites might pop up, that if you're wanting to move and find another place that's beginning to be constructed, it might be advertised in this newspaper. And we had, this was exhibited, it's a traveling show. So Domestic Wilderness Channel was a piece that it was part of an artist residence, and it was looking at how it was exploring surveillance, but also within this residency in California, it was the first time I'd experienced such a mass of wilderness with things such as black widow spiders, spiders that might be this size. And I was terrified of them. And I thought, well, the only way I can go about this is to try and engage with this community of this community that all was kind of like we would never really experience, but we know that as soon as we went to bed, they'd be hovering around us. So I collected these CCD cameras and mapped out the whole landscape around the studio that I was in, and gathered stories and recorded footage of the activities that went on during the night. So it was almost this platform for a theater of nighttime activity. And and experimented with RFID tagging systems so that, again, you know, these narratives could be constructed or gathered or collected so that you would start to understand the space around your home and appreciate it. I think, you know, there's an element in today's society where our way of control is by destruction. And this footage isn't that good because it's so old. But again, the idea was that the footage collected would then be presented on your television the next morning. So it was also kind of a twist on reality TV, where our obsession, you know, with, which I find quite brutal, is kind of like the psychological obsession with reality TV, not psychological obsession. So Neighborhood Watch Files is a project that is thinking and exploring kind of how drones may play a big part in our community. I mean, they already are, but in a way, it's you see here, it's like, is there a possibility for drones to become almost like our pets? So, you know, each home may have 10 or 12 drones that they set off. And it's an opportunity or it's a possibility where they can transform our landscape in a way that collecting data, transmitting data, and that mixture between the real physical landscape and the virtual landscape becomes the boundaries become less defined. So thinking again, you know, about drones in our landscape, you know, it's new types of debris. It's the idea that, you know, are they pets? Are they almost like pets that we can herd and we can send out into the landscape in order to gather and document the spaces around our community? So these are just images that are kind of starting to explore the type of landscape. So Friends of Friends, this was a research project that was we did it as part of media design practices in LA. And it was an Intel-sponsored project, which was looking at collective experiences. We focused this project on driving around LA because obviously in LA, driving is a huge part of the everyday. And cars become people's homes. So we started to think about a new kind of mediated social landscape and observing and understanding kind of the structures of parking lots, of parking garages, new types of parking lots that could allow for tapping in or being connected to social media in a different way. Looking at structures like sports fields, where again the adaptability was really interesting in that if there were parking lots but that then could perform in different ways, how could we create an electronic or digital infrastructure that would allow for not just a parking lot but an alternative behavior? So some of the experiments we carried out, so again, you know, it's very, very, there's a tendency that when you come up with those kind of ideas that it's important to test them out and carry out very basic tests to sample whether these ideas actually might be interesting. So we used car wash sensors and standard parking lot tapes and markings. Started to think about, you know, what if you drive in and the parking lot becomes almost like a switch mechanism in itself. So these tests were simply just seeing whether it was interesting or not to actually use your car as a as a device. Here's the kit that we put together. And using the ceramic discs that they typically use in parking. And then this is one of the experiments we tried out. And it was simply seeing what it was like to experience media moving from a screen that might be in a parking lot onto a screen in the car. One was simply using the car to trigger and affect what was on the monitor that was situated on the tripod. So you had to move the car back and forward to program the screen. And then this was the piece we exhibited, the piece. And then this project went is currently being developed. And again, these are illustrations that just think about how we can kind of create this new system in the city that is that space between the real and the virtual. So these are just images that present different types of activity. You know, one might be a perch that might be a combination of real birds and digital birds. Virtual birds. Another might be a new form of driving space where you could experience or connect with real animals or real pets. And these are just new types of designs for the parking lots. So it's kind of a lot of these projects, you kind of taken them on in different stages, but you know, there are different levels of prototyping. So Captured Landscape is a project that, a recent research project from Digital Plus Media at RISD, and it focuses on the historic and contemporary imaging technology. The collaborative project was investigated how Silicon Valley has redefined the limits of seeing from the pioneering photographic work of Muybridge to NASA's airborne sensor facility. And a lot of inspiration for this project, it was a year-long project, and I would say one big inspiration was Rebecca Solnit. Does anyone know Rebecca Solnit? Yeah. And we went about Captured Landscape in a way that Silicon Valley became our site of investigation. And we researched a lot of material that went back into the very beginning where it was a mixture of Muybridge and Leyland Stanford. So there was a lot of railroad tycoons that started to form Silicon Valley into this new landscape where anything was possible. And Muybridge was part of that, a huge part of that where he was sponsored by Leyland Stanford to demonstrate that a horse, when it gallops, all its hoofs were off the ground. But what happened in that event is it was the beginning of motion film. So we looked back at Silicon Valley at the very beginning and started to plan this expedition that took about three of us across the valley, and we collected and created this collection of tools that would allow us to capture it in a way that was drawing inspiration from a lot of the high-tech equipment that was going on and currently going on. And we picked these sites to investigate. So for example, the one site might be the satellite calibration test at NASA Ames Research Center, or the survey of Sweeney Ridge discovery site. So we kind of picked sites that were specific to both the historical and current events or happenings in Silicon Valley. Here, this is an image of Muybridge's structure that allowed him to capture and demonstrate that the galloping horse lifted all of its hooves off of the ground. So we went back to Stanford, the location where he actually carried out these tests, which is now a golf course, of course. And locations, places that we specifically targeted or investigated were, here you see an image of a device that's used at the DESE lab in Berkeley. They're investigating dark matter. So again, drawing inspiration from tools that they use, but constructing them ourselves in a very analog way. So this was our kit of tools that we took out to the valley. And we started to scan the landscape. And again, you know, we were using very basic off-the-shelf tools like a hand wand scanner. We created our own calibration templates that were drawing images from colors and that were from the internet and matching them up into the landscape. We were using flatbed scanners to do very kind of, this is just a flower that was had a flatbed scanner positioned over it to scan it. And using, instead of using high-tech equipment like drones, we would use a camera on the end of what was called a wonder pole to scan the sign. And this sign historically is really important because it was the first sign of its kind in Silicon Valley. Ampex was the company that developed the magnetic audio tape. Again, these are the kind of scans that we that came out of very simple off-the-shelf tools. And we spent time at NASA Ames. And we took casts of the landscape in Mars Rover. On NASA Ames in Mountain View, McDonald's has been turned into a lab where they're transferring all the images of Moon, they're digitizing them. So it was interesting how the kind of reuse of a space like McDonald's, and you step into this space and it has all the original prints from the Moon. Here you see us scanning the Ampex sign. So we recorded and documented the landscape around Silicon Valley in a way that was almost quite ironic and dumb, but it allowed us to capture it in a very different way. And this piece was exhibited in the Apex Art Gallery in New York recently. So again, it was just presenting this platform that had this collection of media and materials that we'd collected from our expedition along Silicon Valley. And this is the exhibition in Apex Art. And a lot of the material, we presented a lot of the research that was part of Captured Landscape and invited other artists to exhibit as well. So I'm now going to show two public art projects. Just because a lot of the research work, it's interesting because a lot of it feeds into the real built, the public artwork. And public art, you know, coming from an architectural background, public art was is that great space to work in, because it's that space where the discipline of architecture is really important, but you're still being allowed to be conceptually pushing the boundaries slightly. So data nature, actually, I'm just going to hand, can I just pass you these? You can take these, rip them off and take some. Data nature was a public art project for in San Jose, and it was a temporary piece that was only meant to be up for 2 months. So here you see data nature was our commission was to create a gateway between downtown San Jose and the airport, because the airport in San Jose is right in this is downtown. So there's a lot of kind of conflict between noise pollution and the proximity of the planes to the city. So this was a way for the community to connect with the community at the airport. So we positioned it right next to the facilities, because we wanted it to seem like, not necessarily like an artwork, but something that was functional in the city. And we also had a so they became ticket machines. There's a ticket machine downtown, and there was a ticket machine at the airport. The ticket machine downtown had a rotating sign similar, reminiscent of the airport antenna. So part of this project was required almost like a month of being embedded at the airport to understand, you know, like, for example, early in the morning when they when one person has to drive down the runway and pick pieces off of the runway that have fallen off of planes taken off. Or the community of taxi drivers. The burrowing owls that inhabit the airport, because they found they're actually protected. They found a perfect haven because with being at the airport is not allowed to, they're kind of protected by, I can't think what it is. But anyway, there's one guy comes in once a week to check up on all the burrowing owls that inhabit the runway. Not the runway, but the... And then in baggage control, you see they've got weightlifting equipment, barbecues. We collected data that was to do with what was handed in lost and found. Car rentals, we collected data on how many cars were rented each day. Sound abatement. We managed to collect images from the shuttle bus. Maintenance in the restrooms every day. And they even allowed us to hang a camera at the end of the runway. And again, you know, when you do these kind of projects, it's like, how can you make something reasonably quick and cheap, but it also be protected from the heat? Hanging the cameras at the end of the runway allowed us to, when you press the button on the ticket machine, it captured the plane that was just about to land. So the idea was this data was combining with nature, and the perfect tool or the perfect tool for this project was actually a ticket, an airline ticket that we could adapt. In that when this was printed out downtown, instantly people would connect with the airport. But we remixed the ticket and added in aspects of the everyday life from the airport. And this is just a basic kind of illustration of the components that we used within the ticket machine. So you press the button, the camera within the machine takes a picture of you and drops it onto the ticket. So again, you know, it's like when you're thinking of these public interventions, as soon as you make it personal, you engage your audience. So each ticket is unique and it has an image of the person who's just printed the t- ticket, but it also gathers a load of other data from the airport that makes you part of this community. And this is just a selection of some of the tickets. I think this is my favorite one. And the last project, Dreaming Fids, this was another project which was a longer term project at San Jose Airport. And it was looking at surveillance. This was a project that was going to have a lifespan of about 4 years, but it actually ended up having a lifespan of about 7 years. And we were looking at what can we create that would be a mixture of surveillance and something that you wouldn't normally expect within an airport. So we wanted to combine surveillance equipment with fish. And thinking about the programming of people at an airport and maybe applying that to a fish tank. So this is the piece that's really strategically positioned as you step through TSA. So you step through TSA, you're then confronted by a fish tank that allows you to still see through to the runway, but it captures, if you look in the fish tank, it captures you, but it's also capturing mugshots of suspicious fish. Not that there are suspicious fish. And this was drawing inspiration from current software, surveillance software. So this is us just starting to think about surveillance applied to fish. And I'm just going to quickly run through the illustrations that allowed us to develop this piece. You know, types of programming, the components that we would need, the location. So here you see TSA, and then Dreaming Fids was positioned just off the concourse. And an image through the tank of the fish with TSA behind. What was interesting about this piece is that TSA, and again when you do this kind of work, TSA didn't just thought it was a fish tank. And that was kind of the success of it, in that they wanted to look after this fish tank, even though it was a comment on surveillance. But the process of this project was ambitious, and there was a lot of things that we hadn't tried. This was all new to us. You know, what happens when you want to put equipment into a fish tank? You've got to think about the housing of the monitors. And it's not just the technology that works with the programming, it's also the equipment needed to actually keep the tank up and running. And also the fish, the community of fish had to be such that they worked well as a community, and they would swim at a certain height within the tank that would be good, would work with the cameras that were positioned in the middle of the tank. Part of this development of this also required that when you're doing public art, you have to go through a committee. And there was one person on this committee that was concerned about the well-being of the fish. So that they would be affected by having surveillance cameras recording them. So we had to have a company that works with Monterey Aquarium write a letter to say that the fish would be perfectly happy. So that mixture of working with organic matter and technology was a challenge, but an interesting challenge. Even things like the cameras in the water, they had to have a certain type of lens in order that the distance between the camera and the edge of the tank and the fish. And the testing of the initial equipment before it was encased in stainless steel. And checking that all the equipment was waterproof. Here we didn't realize that copper actually affected, was not good for fish tanks, so we had to coat all the copper in another material. Also thinking about structures like this in an airport, it had to be able to be cleaned once a week. Therefore, the technology had to be lifted up and cantilevered out in order that the aquatic company could come in and clean this easily. And then we worked with a fantastic programmer, and this is the setup in the garage, testing the system out and the tank. And our first inhabitants were goldfish, of course, because we were told that they were indispensable. Yeah, and we thought just giving them a little bit of a nice landscape. And these are some of the images from the screens, the monitors, and the equipment that had to be packed into the vertical aspect of the arm. It was difficult also working in the airport because we were only allowed to enter with tools and work when the last plane landed, and we had to be out by the time the first plane was about to take off. So we were working from sometimes midnight through to 4 o'clock over a period of time. And here you see the equipment. And then this is, I'm just going to play this.
start with one just to warm it up. I was very interested in this kind of intersection of artistic intervention and research in your work, and I was wondering what that's, if you can speak to that, because, for instance, the work is kind of, I mean, we see larger teams and big sponsors and things like that, and then there's a very particular sort of artistic agency or artistic kind of intention behind it as well, and I was just thinking if you can just speak to that experience in working in these kinds of projects, and what's the role of research, what's the role of what we would traditionally sort of call, you know, this kind of artistic intent in the work.
I think that I'm not sure quite if I'm going to answer your question right, but working, you know, the artistic research is valuable, is precious in the, but it's in a lot of the work, it sits within different arenas, but I would say that the artistic research is the essence or the heart and soul of where you can truly experiment and develop ideas that then can be utilized or used within built pieces like public art or, but it's actually, if I think about survival in doing that kind of work, that's where it's, again, it's a balance is in that you can do the constructed public artwork or that allows you to then kind of take time and sacrifice for the more artistic. It's hard to explain. I think, I don't think we could do the built physical work without doing the artistic research. You know, the artistic research is, I mean, within architecture, you do artistic research, right? It's a way, it's artistic research is another way, another word for experimentation and exploration or interrogation. But it also allows you to test out on smaller scale aspects that then might be carried through when you do a bigger built project. So it's kind of allowing you just to be much more open-minded. Because when you do pieces like the public artwork, you have constraints in the same way that you do in architecture, and constraints are good. I think they're healthy. It's good to have constraints. That's why, again, I love doing public art, because to me, working within the gallery context is almost too easy, whereas the constraints of having to build an artwork that has longevity, that deals with a very different audience, is a great challenge.
I see that you have quite a bit of a public art project. So I wonder what is your attitude towards the function of public art to the society now, or what is the function towards the society, like how people would think about it. Do you think it serves as a function or not?
It's interesting. I was on a panel in Long Beach last year where they were looking at public art that deals with technology and how you archive it or its longevity again. And I think that public art historically it's a touchy area because it's the public's money. It's the people from the city are the ones that are putting money into this work. So it's an audience that is very, very important. But when you're doing public art that involves technology, I don't believe it should have a lifespan of more than 5 or 10 stretching at years, because public art, again, is historically is with us forever. You know, if you look historically at public art, it's either made out of marble, concrete, steel, and it sits within the city for as long as it rusts and it falls apart. Whereas I think public art is should be about now, and that now might be around a 5-year period and then be removed, because it's, I think public art is something that does, it does have an opportunity to step outside of the gallery and have a voice with the public, public sphere, and question, you know, public art should be questioning and encouraging that questioning rather than just being something that has had a lot of money put into it, that almost treats the everyday public as naive or and a lot of public art I find insults the public, the society, in a way. I think you know, we have a responsibility where art can step out into the everyday and be something meaningful and playful.
Just following up on the same question, how did you find the response or engagement of the public in some of your projects? Were like the expected response or like some unexpected or?
That's the biggest reward for doing public art. And again, you don't get that in a gallery. You know, in a gallery, it's very much this conversation that kind of leaves you feeling a little bit hollow. Whereas in public art, for example, with Dreaming Fids, you know, everybody had a different experience or interaction with it. I mean, it was interesting to hang around the tank for a couple of days, and everybody had their own conceptual idea. It doesn't matter who they were. Some people would come up and laugh about it. Some people would come up and again just think it was a fish tank. That doesn't matter. Other people would get the ironic twist. And, you know, the TSA, that was highly entertaining. And it wasn't being cheeky, because it was playful as well. And I think within public art and dealing with technology or working with technology, there's a lot of public art that is very gimmicky for the sake of entertainment, but I think if you can create work that does have a slight conversation, you know, a deeper conversation within it based on its context. The ticket machine was great because people would walk away laughing, you know, and because their picture's on it. But that's it, they took it away because their picture's on it, but they're taking away something that they might look at in more detail later. So for me, public art, yes, I want it to have a deep and underlying meaning, but I want the public to not walk up to it and go, well, this is a piece of art. I want there to be that confusion or kind of that they it engages with them in a way that's not intimidating.
Are you trying to, for example, deliver a message through your public art, or do you think it's not necessary?
It's not, it is, because yes, in some, you know, some people might take away a message, but others might not. But it doesn't matter. I think all the pieces have kind of developed from a concept or an investigation of that specific site. But if someone doesn't get that message, that's fine. Some people will. Some people will instantly look at this piece for like Dreaming Fids and go, well, it's surveillance and it's outside TSA, so this is kind of amusing in an ironic way. Other people, and again, you know, it's a broad audience that you have to cater for. You have to cater for kids that come up and just want to see their face on the monitors.
It's also okay that you don't get it.
Yeah.
And I think that attitude, to me, it's a little bit, going back to your point that it belittles the public, or you're trying to think, you know, if you get it, great. If you don't, you're stupid. So.
No, I don't think it's if you don't, you're stupid. I think.
And then the artist would say, well, if you're stupid, fine.
Yeah. No, but they'll, it's not, I don't think it's, you should never go in with an arrogant attitude as an artist. And I think I don't think we do, because I think someone walking away
It doesn't mean if they walk away and they don't get it that they're stupid at all. They walk away with something. I might walk up to something and not quite get it, but I guess that means I'm stupid. I don't know.
We have a few more minutes for questions, so maybe, I don't know, if there are many students also from the design and computation group, so if you also wanted to, I don't know, sort of open a dialogue, we have a little bit of time, so you're welcome to ask questions, you're also welcome to engage in dialogue with the audience, if you...
Actually, I'm intrigued to know what kind of work you guys do.
Critical reading and writing that's historical or theoretical in nature, to work with sensors and actuators and physical stuff. Interest in fabrication, interest in software. It's a very diverse group, and the group is not confined to particular courses that we teach as faculty, but they go everywhere at MIT.
That sounds a bit like our program, actually.
Yeah, it's a very open-ended program, very flexible.
There is a way to make a technology in art that does not go obsolete.
But that's kind of the conference I was, or symposium I was at in Long Beach, and one piece was brought up. It's like, you know, one of the first pieces was one of Nam June Paik's piece. You're dealing with monitors that are obsolete. I don't think you can get away from things becoming quickly obsolete. I don't think that's a bad thing. I think, again, you know, within thinking about public art, if something is obsolete, then that's fine. It's like, okay, so let's create another piece that is current. But it is a challenge for conservators in that how do you catalog? How do you keep work that is, you know, involves technology. The Dreaming FIDS project, the monitors lasted 4 years, and now I still go back to that airport, and I wish they would take the piece out because the budget only allowed for it to. The monitors weren't that expensive, but they're fading now. So I think there's something about, again, when you do this kind of work, the public pays for something, so they don't necessarily want to see it go, but there's a point when the budget has only allowed for it to be built to survive for a certain length of time. And you've also got to think about the maintenance. The Dreaming FIDS project, a huge budget went to maintenance for both the technology, but for the upkeep of the fish tank, because in a public place, if someone sees a dead fish floating around, or there's a dark, you know, a foggy tank, which sometimes is healthier, people will complain. There are times when I'd fly back through that airport, and once or twice, this was on a weekly basis, there was a fish. I mean, it's inevitable, there'll be dead fish. So I'd had to take a chair from TSA, stand on it, and pull the fish out and throw it in the trash bin next door. Yeah, it's a good question. Yeah, I think it does.
But I mean, maybe a loose follow-up. I just thought it was really interesting
that was really a striking aspect, and maybe something that in our group as well, when we talk about design, I mean, how do we talk about design in all those scales and the role of computing and technology and design again, not just in the scale of the gadget, but really,
bigger.
You know, also, yeah.
Yeah, it's, I mean, with my students, you know, you enter a department that's called digital plus media, everybody instantly thinks they have to know Arduino, they have to know this, but really we try and kind of start with the students to think, to not even think necessarily about the technology, or maybe think about the consequences of the technology, but not jump to using the tools, to look at, to investigate and interrogate and question the consequences of technology in our everyday, you know, from small scale to landscape scale, and develop concepts that think about that, that then naturally move forward, and then if they might not use technology to talk about, to use in their work, but some of them who do, it comes after. It's not like the technology is driving them, but the concept's driving them, because it's easy, so easy to be seduced by technology. I don't know. I don't really like labeling.
Yeah,
but
that's
yeah, I think so. And this kind of, I mean, a lot of the work, not the public work is different, but a lot of the research is really difficult to try and communicate. And that's a challenge. You know, how do you, when a project is a year long, it can't simply become a website, you know, it's a documentation. Maybe that's where it sits more in the anthropological side of things. I don't think this kind of work necessarily, it does work with companies, you know, like some of the projects were sponsored by Intel or IBM, so they're more, they are research, but they're research that might be further thinking, but that a company like Intel or that could draw inspiration from. But I don't think necessarily a lot of the work that there's proposals for devices could come out of this research. Yeah. I guess it's kind of, we go in with tools or technologies and use them in a way that it's not about being functional, but it's a tool that is an intervention that allows for a questioning rather than a solution. And that questioning is, the results of those questioning is what gives companies that don't want to spend money or on artistic research necessary.
Mm-hmm. So what
there's always that, as an artist or more of a designer, that you have to create something that's for everybody. But that's actually really difficult, and you can, if you go about trying to design something for everybody, it would fail. So I think it's just seeing how people engage, and you know, you're within public art, you're not given a second chance, but you see what works. And a couple of my students are starting to venture into public art, and it's amazing how they refuse. I mean, they're learning now, but to have an idea, you have to test it out and find a way to test it out to see if it would be successful. I mean, with the fish tank, anything with fish in it is going to attract people. So it's kind of those levels of engagement in that. I loved seeing kids go up to this fish tank because they would just be tapping on the tank, and I don't know how to value that. I think, you know, I have memories, or I have with the ticket, for example, the ticket. I think both were, and I don't mean that in an arrogant way, I think they were both successful because you see people enjoying them, even though they have a critical, conceptual kind of backing to them. And that's not saying that they're stupid. I like to laugh, I like to have fun with art. So I think you can be intellectual and still walk away feeling stupid.
Concluding thoughts or questions? There is one concluding, of course there will be.
So I never gone through art school, but I wonder how, particularly technology related art project, how are their artistic value being evaluated?
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, because I've ended up in an artistic world, but I have an architectural design background. So, again, it's not about the technology, it's the thinking behind why you've used that technology. So within an artistic context, you're talking about within a gallery context? Again, it's difficult because technology, there's a lot of art that's being produced where it's about that one line or that gimmickiness, whereas I think a lot of the art that's thinking about technology, again, might be using technology as a tool, but it's not clearly evident in the gallery. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I think it's it's not seeing the final thing. Again, you know, some students come in and they don't think, but they just leap in and start to construct something. For me, the success is that even if it is something that is extremely simple at the end, I want to know that they've really interrogated that and spent a decent amount of time. You know, if they end up with one device or piece of technology that does one very simple thing, but they've spent a semester or an academic year working on this, and I've seen that process, that's where they're evaluated. And they've stepped out of, again, they're not sitting in front of the computer, there's a lot where they've really challenged themselves to push the boundaries of what they're exploring. And that's through kind of critical, kind of theoretical reading, historical,
Thank you very much for the presentation and discussion.
Thank you.